Hello and welcome to this special edition of Living Black, coming to you from Melbourne. I'm Carla Grant. We're here in the Victorian capital for the Dreamtime at the G celebrations. Later in the show, we talk reconciliation with Essendon great Michael Long. Also in today's program, imprisoned for a decade without conviction, mentally impaired WA man Marlon Noble seeks justice.
And I like it in there, and I like it.
High emotion in Brisbane as police move in on the Aboriginal tent embassy.
This takes me back to 1971, back to the height of the jail years.
And back again for another performance in studio, the Stiff Gins. But first, the WA government has committed $18 million to establish declared places to house intellectually disabled people who have been accused but not convicted of a crime. But this news comes too late for mentally impaired man Marlon Noble. Alan Clark reports.
No good in jail. Not good. Not feel good for me. Not feel good for my families. And I like it in there. And I like it.
Sitting in his backyard in Geraldton, midwestern WA, Marlon Noble is talking about his decade-long ordeal in prison.
I'm missing my lot. Last 10 years. My life, I missed it.
It's a long and complicated entanglement with the Western Australian justice system that has robbed Marlon of his youth. Marlon suffers from an intellectual impairment caused by a bout of meningitis as a child. He has below average intelligence and cognitive difficulties. At 19, Marlon was questioned by police over stolen alcohol. He left that interrogation charged as a sex offender. The police have not been forthcoming about why.
The case involving Marlon Noble is just another further disgraceful episode in a sad run of cases in Western Australia. We look at Marlon's case. He is innocent. Yes, the police arrested him and locked him up, but he was never put to trial.
In 2002, Marlon was charged with sexually assaulting two minors. Shortly after, he was found unfit to stand trial due to his mental handicap. Marlon was in limbo, no conviction, but still not exonerated. The court decided to hold him in custody. With no facility for intellectually disabled people, prison was the only option. In 2010, a psychologist declared Marlon fit for trial, but the Department of Public Prosecution declines to take the matter to court, instead withdrawing the charges. 2011, the alleged victims come forward to deny Marlon ever assaulted them. Released in January this year, Marlon has paid a high price for his freedom. He's essentially under house arrest. The Mentally Impaired Accused Review Board has placed 9 strict conditions on his release, including not being able to spend the night away from his residence without permission, and also a ban on his hometown of Carnarvon, the place where his mother is buried. Other conditions include not to associate with girls under the age of 16 and not to drink alcohol.
These are the sort of conditions we place upon a vicious sex murderer who's been convicted and who we reluctantly let out into the community. Marlon, on the other hand, is innocent. Gold-plated innocent. No one's questioning that.
Shadow Attorney General John Quigley says his only crime was being Aboriginal and mentally handicapped.
Oh, I've got no doubt that there'd be more outrage if this was the son of someone from Cottesloe, the Premier's electorate. They'd be up in arms.
If Marlon had been convicted in the first instance, he would have spent less time behind bars. Greens MP Alison Zamon is lobbying the government for an independent inquiry into the case.
I think there's a very serious question to be asked about why disability services really weren't on the ground providing Marlon with the services that he, I think, was entitled to at the time that he was charged with the offences, which he has never been found guilty of.
The Mentally Impaired Accused Review Board and the Western Australian Attorney General Christian Porter declined interview requests from Living Black. During his time as an inmate, Marlon was surrounded by hardened convicts and violent offenders, left vulnerable within the system. Family friend Ida Courtois stood by Marlon through the tough times and campaigned tirelessly for his freedom.
I said, well, now you're out. I said, now what do you want to do? He said, I want to be clear my name and I want to be free. And I said, oh, I said, rightio. I said, we'll get working on that, but it'll take me time. And he just looked at me with this sad face and he said, it won't take another 10 years though, will it?
Ida says prison has taken a tragic toll on Marlon. She recalls Marlon's distress at finding out his mother had been viciously murdered, her body dumped on a remote road via the TV news in jail.
So I saw him at the funeral handcuffed and that was the most soul-searching time I've ever had, I think, with him. You know, he was at his mother's funeral, handcuffed to two big prison officers, standing outside. He couldn't even put his hands up to wipe his nose and wipe away his tears. He had no time at the cemetery to be with his family.
I got a hurting me now. I got nowhere to, and I call no mother no more now. No mother, and there's mothers and the mother dad. I want mum there for me, with me, but they're not.
This is how Marlon escapes his judicial nightmare. Cruising around on his favourite dirt bike, it's the feeling of freedom on his wheels that he cherishes the most. Off the bike, Marlon's world is very different.
Yeah, I want to be day on my court. I want to go into court. Big day. I want to clean my name. I want to say to the judge. I want to say clean my name. I want to walk out of that door. I want to walk out that door. I'm a happy man. I want to go to the coffee shop. I have a coffee. Sweet ass. Bang. He dropped. So you got Emma. Drank. Bang on the table. Yep. You're clear then, son. Move.
A review of Marlon's release conditions is due later this year. Until then, his supporters will continue to fight for what they say is a grave miscarriage of justice.